My castaway this week is a politician and a turbulent priest. His combination of religious fervour and political passion has won him one of the most sizeable majorities at Westminster and the largest vote of any politician in the European Parliament. For 20 years, he has personified Ulster Protestantism at its loudest and most determined. He's been called the Demon Doctor, the Mad Mullah, but those who know him say he is a man of considerable compassion and humour. They know him fondly as the big man. He is the Reverend Ian Paisley. Mr. Paisley, I've been told that if you're in a collar and tie, I can relax. If you're wearing your clerical collar, I should beware. I see I can relax this morning.
Well, I don't think that that's true at all. I think I'm the same person, no matter what garb I wear.
You wouldn't admit to there being two sides to your personality, because that's what people say, that you can be humorous and charming, but you, on the other hand, can be really quite threatening.
No, I think that a person is the same person. But, of course, when they're dealing with the sobering aspects of the life that my constituents are going through, being bombed and murdered and killed and put under pressure day and daily, there must be a very sober side and there must be a very stern and strong side.
Well, there's nobody on this desert island for you to speak to. There's nobody to argue with. There's nobody to love. I mean, will you hate it for that, being cast away?
Well, I develop my voice by addressing the stones and trees of the Mourne Mountains. So I suppose I could address the birds and the fish and the stars and the waves. I think I would continue to speak.
Let's hear your first record.
Well, my first record is a 23rd Psalm. I was a child, my mother told me, who made the day into night and the night into day. And the only song that would put me over to sleep was the singing of the 23rd Psalm. I hope it doesn't put you to sleep.
The 23rd Psalm, sung by the Reformed Presbyterian Church of Ireland, the only music that would calm Ian Paisley as a baby. So you were awkward even then, were you?
I was awkward even then, yes.
What sort of upbringing did you have?
Well, I was brought up in a manse. It was a very strict upbringing, very strong on behaviour and ethics, and rightly so. And I look back with great thanksgiving to my upbringing.
Who had the greater influence on you, your mother or your father?
I would say equally both. My mother was a Covenanter from Scotland, and my father at that time was a Baptist preacher. And both of them had a very big influence on me. My father especially, he was my hero and always will be my hero.
So you were very properly brought up, you were very pious, you were very well behaved. Did you ever go out?
No, I wasn't pious, nor I wasn't well behaved either. I was just an ordinary boy, and sometimes pulled against the rigours that were imposed upon me, and in fact made up my mind that if I ever had children, I would make a few changes, and I think I made those changes when I brought up my own family.
What sort of changes?
Well, I think that there must be a willingness to allow a person to develop their own way. And in the old way of Christian upbringing, I think perhaps too much pressure was put on children in the home to conform.
But you still run, as I understand it, quite a tight ship. I mean, there's no smoking, no drinking, no swearing, good behaviour in your household.
Oh, well, I mean, those are the common decencies, I think, that should be in every home. But with all the rigours of a strict upbringing, I look back on those days as very, very happy days. And both my father and mother did a very good job on me.
Did you feel, if you're honest, even then, when you were really quite young, that there was something special about you?
No, I never felt there was anything special about me. I don't feel there's anything special about me even today. I think I'm just an ordinary individual who has a job of work to do and is doing it to the best of his ability.
But it's been said that Jesus Christ came to you when you were 6 years old.
Yes, I was converted to Christ when I was 6 years of age. That is absolutely true. And, of course, conversion is the greatest possible experience in any human being's life. I listened to my mother speaking on a text in John 10, I am the good shepherd, giveth his life for his sheep. And that day, that text made a tremendous impression upon me. And I simply, as a child, received Christ, as he says, we should receive him, as my Lord and Saviour. I have been a total and absolute failure as far as I am concerned, but he has been an absolute success for me.
Let's have your second record.
Well, my second record is sung by William McEwen, who was a great gospel singer, and he was the first gospel singer I ever heard recorded. And strange to relate, I was able to discover one of these very old records with a very appropriate piece pulled for the shore. So I thought that being on the desert island, somebody must have pulled me ashore. So I thought this would be appropriate. And it has, of course, a spiritual message as well.
Light in the darkness, sailor, a day is at hand. See o'er the foaming billows, rear heaven's land. Drear was the voyage, sailor, now almost o'er. Safe within the lifeboat, sailor, pull for the shore. Pull for the shore, sailor, pull for the shore. Heed not the rolling waves, but bend to the oar. Safe in the lifeboat, sailor, cling to self no more. Leave the poor old stranded wreck and pull for.
Pull for the Shore, sung by William McEwen. Are you going to try and pull away from the shore, Mr. Paisley? I mean, will you try and escape from the island?
Well, I would have some things that I want to do on this island, and then I might make preparations to escape.
Are you a practical man, then? Could you lash a few palm trees together?
Yes, I have quite an experience in joinery and woodwork. And I think I could make a raft. I think also I could get a sail somewhere. I think that I could commit myself to the deep in quiet confidence. And being a Calvinist, knowing that all things work together for good, I might arrive somewhere.
When was the moment that you knew it was your destiny, if you like, to preach?
Well, that was when I was 15. And I was in the County Tyrone with a friend of mine who was a farmer. And I was using a harrow with two horses. And that day I had a conscious experience of God calling me to be a preacher of the gospel. I didn't see angels. I didn't see anything, but it's an experience of the heart. Where I felt that this was the way that I had to go.
You believe, I know, and it comes through everything that you say, that you have been chosen, that you perform God's will. That's a belief which presumably then guards you against so many ills, including fear of death at the hands of the IRA.
Yes. Could I just say I believe that everyone can experience the choice of God. And everyone should. The choice of God is the choice that Christ emphasized when he said, ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. And that is grace. I don't have any fear of death because the scriptures tell us that those that know Christ have been delivered from that fear. I walked with death for many, many years and will continue to walk with it until one day death, the king of terrors and the terror of kings and the last great enemy will conquer me. if the advent of Christ doesn't intervene between that date and this.
And do you believe that you'll suffer a violent death?
No, I don't think so. I have never given it consideration. I mean, I don't get up in the morning and say, is this the day the IRA are going to shoot me? I live a normal life.
Let's pause there and let me ask you for your third record.
Well, my third record is a hymn sung by my own congregation, which, of course, is my first love. I've been on the Ravenhill Road now for 42 years. It's a gospel hymn, an evangelistic hymn. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood.
Would You Be Free, sung by the congregation of Dr. Paisley's own church, the Martyrs Memorial Free Presbyterian Church in Belfast. Now, Ian Paisley, you met your wife Eileen when she was 17 and you were 24. She says it was love at first sight. Is that how you remember it?
Yes, I think that is absolutely right. And we had a wonderful courtship, and we're still having a wonderful courtship after many years of married life. She's my right hand.
You call her the boss, I guess.
I call her the boss. And I always say the neck turns the head. Yes.
What does she call you?
She calls me many things. I wouldn't like to repeat in this program. or some people might think she was too Christian.
A lot of bunches of flowers, I gather, wing their way from all the various points of Europe in which you are back home to Belfast.
Oh, yes. I always think that the woman at home needs to have all the encouragement and all the love and help that she ought to have. I'm glad I wasn't born a woman.
Why would you hate to be a woman?
Well, I don't like a woman's tasks in the home. I mean, the children were young and my wife wasn't well, I had to do the chores. And I don't take to cooking.
So you don't help around the house?
Not now. I did help around the house, and of course at some times in holiday time I would help around the house. But I have three daughters, and I think that they are their mother's right hand.
Now, which one of your children, and you have five, three daughters and twin boys, which one of them, or how many of them, are destined to pick up the Paisley banner and carry it forward when we have cast you away?
Well, I don't know. I would say that my family largely have the same basic convictions that I have, and certainly the same Christian conviction, but they're all individuals. I think that they all have a very strong independent streak in them, and they do their own thing and they do their own way.
What, of course, you have brought on that family that you love so much is a life covered at every turn by security.
Yes.
Police protection, bulletproof glass in the house, rocket screens for garden fences, and Paisley for a name, of course.
Yes.
Do you ever, for their sakes, if not for your own, wish that you had never begun to march along this treacherous Ulster path?
No, I never have any regrets that I have gone the road I've gone, because I'm conscious that it was a preordained path as far as I was concerned. We all have regrets in life, some things we have done differently, but I have no major regrets because I believe I've gone the way that God would have me go. No, I think that they have coped very well with the name. They have made their own way in the world and will make their own way in the world.
So they're not a family who live in fear and a small amount of resentment?
Oh, no. I am the chum of all my family. I have their confidence, and they come to me on all occasions. And matters that concern them, they would discuss openly with me. and with Eining as well. I mean, we are a very close-knit family, and we have the best of times on our holidays. We always spend our holiday together, and then we let down our hair and enjoy ourselves.
What do you do?
Everything that they say I have to do. I don't have any. The only thing I do, I usually write an odd book on my holiday, and at night I would spend a little time on my own doing some researching. But they say, this is what you're doing today, Dad, this is the way you're going to go. And if I protest, you're doing what we say today. So
let me ask you for another record.
Well, the next record is the Londonderry Air, sung by Robert White, O Danny Boy, and of course all Ulster people, no matter what their beliefs may be, really their hearts warm to this particular song.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling from glen to glen and down the mountain side. The summer's gone and all the roses fall. And I must buy.
Oh, Danny Boy, the Londonderry Air, sung by Robert White. It is lovely, isn't it?
It is indeed.
Ian Paisley, you started to gain notoriety in the 60s. The ecumenical movement was growing in influence, and that was something which you staunchly opposed. And it was in 1963, when the Pope, Pope John, died, that you told a mass meeting, "This Romish man of sin is now in hell." Did you mean that?
Well, I don't know whether you got the quote right, but I'm sure that the sentiment was right. I don't know whether I expressed it in those words or not. I hear myself quoted on many occasions in words that may try to get the sense. What I did say was that the reform position that has always been the position of the Reformed churches and is the position of the Westminster Confession of Faith, which every Presbyterian minister, whether it be Irish Presbyterian, Reformed Presbyterian, or Free Presbyterian, or Evangelical Presbyterian, sign on their ordination, states it clearly that the Pope is that Antichrist, that man of sin, that son of perdition in the church. Now, anti means instead of Christ. And the Church of Rome itself claims that the Pope takes the place of Christ. He's the vicar or the substitute for Christ on earth. The priest in the confessional box claims that he takes the place of Christ and can forgive sins. It takes the place of Christ at the altar, in the Mass ceremony, and in the sacrifice. And this has always been the position of the Protestant Church. There's nothing new about this. And because a person today repeats the strong teaching of Protestantism, one is more or less pilloried and say, that's an awful thing to say. But that is Protestantism, and for that I make no apology.
But what I think it worries people, the ferocious terms in which you state it, the sometimes savage terms in which you state it. And I think that people would want to say to you, can't it be done more gently than that?
Well, I don't think the Inquisition was gentle. I don't think the history of Rome was gentle. So I think that one must speak openly. I mean, I speak openly on these things. I don't hide myself.
But
and I think that it is important that we have open debate on these things.
Indeed. But
I mean, I could give you statements what they've said about me that consign me to the lower regions, and that's their business. I have no objection to a Roman Catholic speaking as harshly or as dogmatically about his faith, but please let me speak strongly about my faith.
Is what you're saying that God prefers Protestants?
No, I'm saying that all Protestants and all Roman Catholics and all atheists and all of every other religion are sinners before God, and they have got to be saved by God's grace. There's no difference between any of us. And there's no doubt there are those within the Roman Catholic system that know the grace of God. The system of Romanism I utterly deplore and protest against, but individual Roman Catholics have the same standing with me as individual Protestants, both in my religious work and in my political work, as they all testify.
I want to go on to ask you about how your religion moved into politics, but before we do, let me ask you for your fifth record.
Well, the fifth record is from a flute, an accordion band in my constituency, my old constituency of Banside, the first constituency, the Killiecookin accordion band. It's playing a piece, Bound for Texas Land. It's a good Ulster flavour about it.
Killiecookin Accordion Band playing Bound for Texas Land. Well now, Mr. Pacey, at what point in your life did you come to believe that the role God wanted you to play was not only a religious one, but a political one as well?
Well, when the serious situation arose in Northern Ireland and the slide was taking place to anarchy, I had prophesied that this would come because I saw on the horizon the dark clouds of lawlessness, and I also saw the weakness of the unionist administration not prepared to face up honestly to what was really happening, sweeping things as governments like to do under the carpet, and then leaving a terrible harvest, sowing the wind and reaping the whirlwind, as the scriptures say. And I then was constrained by the call of the people of Northern Ireland to do what I set out to do.
Now, you have, as I said at the beginning, won impressive majorities always, which has given you a deal of power. And on occasions, you have used that power to incite hatred, as we've been discussing. Hatred which can lead to violence. Have you ever felt regret for actions which have stemmed from your words?
Well, I have never incited anybody to hate. I mean, I would repudiate that, absolutely. And perhaps you'd give me some example where I incited people to it. I've been brought onto the streets by the British authorities to try and keep trouble from going in the streets. I have been got out of my bed by army officers who have said, would you please come? Because if you don't come, there will be trouble. Well, if I was an inciter to hate, I think I would have laid on in my bed and I wouldn't have been there. So, I mean, I would totally and absolutely reject that, and I think that...
But it's certainly true, is it not, Mr. Paisley, that in the late 60s, for example, the Cameron Commission said that you had contributed to the prolonged troubles in Ulster?
The Cameron Commission was a commission that didn't examine anybody under oath. I was in jail when the Cameron Commission sat. So they sat in judgment on a man who never was heard and who was in jail. Well, if you think that's fair play on British justice, I don't. In fact, let us come to the Scarman Commission, which was a public sworn inquiry. And the Scarman Commission cleared me completely of having any responsibility for the violence in the streets of Ulster. You can read it for yourself. And the Scarman Commission was a public sworn inquiry. I don't believe in backdoor government inquiries. I believe that if you're going to have an inquiry, you should have them on oath. And everybody should appear on oath and should be cross-examined. And I treat the Cameron Commission, and so does the Ulster people, and so now does government officials, with the utmost contempt.
Isn't it possible that by being so strident, by being so, some would say, intransigent, that you alienate those who might otherwise give you sympathy and support?
No, I don't think so. I think that the British people will learn in a hard school, and we're not depending upon the sympathy of the people over here. We have got to depend upon ourselves. We have been so betrayed. We have been so treated with contempt by successive British governments. The Ulster people know they have to stand on their own feet.
Let's pause there and let me ask you for your sixth record now.
My sixth record is that very famous hymn by John Newton, Amazing Grace. It's sung by the Bob Jones University Concert Choir. And, of course, I have close connections with the Bob Jones University.
They gave you a doctorate.
They did. Part of the Bible Belt. It's known as the buckle on the Bible Belt in fundamentalist, the southern states of America. And, of course, Amazing Grace is a wonderful hymn.
Amazing Grace, sung by the Bob Jones University Concert Chorale. You cope, Ian Paisley, with an extraordinary workload. You are, as we said, a member of both the Westminster and the European Parliaments, and you still manage to preach regularly.
Oh, yes, I preach in my own church twice each Sabbath, and also I preach in one of our other churches in the afternoon.
And do you prepare those sermons, or do you stand there and proclaim?
Oh, no. You have to prepare sermons. You can't preach to your congregation for 42 years and say the same thing, or you'd be addressing Mr. and Mrs. Wood and Timothy Timber, and rightly so.
So when do you do all that preparation?
Well, I am driven from place to place. 6 hours of sleep does me, and between the rest of the times travelling over here, travelling to Europe, I have plenty of time for study and research. And then, of course, I burn the midnight oil on a Saturday night as well.
You also undoubtedly have an eye for publicity. Does it give you some pleasure, your fame, your celebrity?
I'm not a glutton for fame. I just do my thing, and if it comes that way, well, that's it.
Certainly comes that way.
Well, it certainly does, but I mean, I don't set out to make myself famous. I don't. I think that fame is a very, it's a folly, because Christ was very famous when he was doing his miracles, but the same crowd that enjoyed the loaves and fishes cried, "Crucify him." And public applaud is something that is very fickle.
Another record, please.
This record is by a coloured singer, Bertha Dorman, a very good personal friend of mine, "Thy Way, O Lord." When I was a boy, the Jubilee Singers visited our country, and I was greatly impressed by their singing and by their fervour. And I think one of the greatest coloured singers in the world today is Bertha.
Since thou for me didst bleed, and now dost intercede, each day
"My Way, O Lord," sung by Bertha Norman. Well, Mr. Paisley, we're now about to cast you away on the desert island. You may never be rescued, at which some would undoubtedly be delighted and others would be devastated. But eventually we would come to write your obituary. What would you most like to be remembered for? What have you achieved?
Well, I would most like to be remembered for as a preacher of the gospel and as a person who brought the truth of the gospel to many hearts.
And will you, Reverend Paisley, when your moment comes and you face the Lord, will you face him with a clear conscience?
I will face him as a sinner who deserved eternal hell and judgment. But I will face him not in any righteousness of my own, for my righteousnesses are as filthy rags, but in the imputed righteousness of his Son, who lived for men, who died for men, who shed his blood for men, who at this moment is praying for man, and all that come to him he will in no wise cast out.
Let me ask you for your eighth and your final record, if you will.
The eighth record is sung by my parliamentary colleague and also my ministerial colleague, who was once an assistant minister of mine, the Reverend William McCrae, the Member of Parliament for Mid-Ulster, and one of the leading, if not the leading, gospel singer in the United Kingdom. And it's a good, arousing piece, "When the Trumpet of the Lord Shall Sound and Time Shall Be No More."
When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. There's a whole lot of people going home. By the signs of time, it won't be very long. In the twinkling of an eye, we'll all be gone. There's a whole lot of people going home.
When the Trumpets of the Lord Shall Sound, sung by the Reverend William McCrae, MP. Now, which of all those records you've chosen there, which one would you cherish above all others?
I think that possibly the 23rd Psalm.
Now, you have the Bible, and we also, as you know, give you the complete works of Shakespeare. What other piece of literature of your thousands of books would you like to take?
Well, I would like to take an authorized version of the Holy Scriptures, if that's permissible. And it would be, I'd like to take what is known as the Companion Bible, which has extensive notes. So perhaps you might be able to work that one for me.
I'm sure we can. So there's a lot of hard research going to go on.
That's right, that's right. I have thought carefully about what book I would like to take. Very difficult one. But John Bunyan was in prison for 12 years. And he read a very big work, The Acts and Monuments of John Fox, which is better known to the general public as Fox's Book of Martyrs. It's an 8-volume set, and I think I would like to have that, because I have never had time to read it, and I'd like to take time to read it and perhaps get some of the inspiration that Bunyan got when he wrote his Pilgrim's Progress.
A collected works, I think, pushes the rules a little, but as you're going to work so hard, you can have it.
Thank you.
And finally, your luxury.
I said to my wife, could I take you? You'd be my luxury. She said, no, I'd not be there. So I would like a high-powered radio that I could find out what was happening. And in my loneliness, could set the world right and say what I would do in such circumstances.
You shall have it. Ian, Richard, Kyle Paisley, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.